Okay, so in this course we have dealt with first of all a rigid crystal, a rigid lattice. Then we looked at the vibrational modes of the rigid lattice, and those were the phonons. Then we looked at electrons without any crystalline potential, any periodic potential, so that was the free electron gas. Then we brought back the rigid crystal and looked at electrons in a periodic potential. So that gave us the band structure, right? But now we want to look at, let's say we push the system out of equilibrium and then we want to study transport phenomena. And this could include thermal transport as well as electrical transport. Then how does one do that? Okay. So there are various levels at which this transport phenomena can be considered. And the level at which we are going to restrict ourselves to is a semi-classical level, okay, for reasons that I'll tell you as we go along. And there is, we could bring back the phonons and look at electron-phonon interactions and how they influence phonon transport or electron transport, for example, within this formalism. We can also look at how electrons interact with other electrons, and then how does that influence the electrical transport or the thermal transport. So all of this can be done within a certain formalism called the Boltzmann transport formalism. So that is what we want to reach. Okay, so that will be the goal of this particular class, Boltzmann transport formalism. But before I introduce Boltzmann transport formalism, let me go over the formalisms that you may be familiar with. Okay. So let's first consider Newtonian dynamics. And then we will come to, so Newtonian dynamics is completely classical. And then we could have, let's say, semi-classical dynamics. And in semi-classical dynamics, you can have a single electron formalism, which means a one particle formalism where interactions between electrons or electrons and phonons are not considered. And the next level where...
sir?
Yes?
Hello?
Hello? Sorry, I couldn't hear you. Can you repeat that? Hello. Someone said something, no? It's okay. Does anybody know who said that? Okay.
Sir, okay. I think it was Gautam Das.
Gautam, okay. Yeah, but Gautam is not yet joined. I guess he joined and then he got disconnected. Yeah, he's right now not on the participant list. So let's see. When he joins, then he can ask. All right, so in the semi-classical dynamics, again, you can have a single electron formalism. Or you can have a multi-electron formalism, or you can have electrons, phonons, and other scattering mechanisms. Okay. And beyond that, you can have a full quantum treatment. And this necessarily involves quantum many-body theory. Okay, so and this goes as something called non-equilibrium Green's function formalism or Geldish formalism and so on. So within the scope of this course, it's only up to here that we will restrict ourselves to. And in the advanced solid state physics, for example, we do a full quantum treatment of the transport where we introduce Green's functions and then go over how these Green's functions get modified when you apply an electric field or a thermal gradient and so on. Okay. So let's first look at Newtonian dynamics. Okay. And let me ask, Unnimaya, are you online? Hello, Unnimaya, are you online? No? Okay. Surbhi, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Surbhi, so suppose I have a system of classical particles. So think of a box, and let's say I had a system of charged particles which are classical. And say I apply an electric field to this. So how should I start describing these particles? So in other words, the first thing you should tell me is, suppose I ignore all the collisions. Okay, imagine that these are all ideal gas particles. They don't interact with each other, but they all have a charge. And this charge is very special in the sense that they don't repel each other. They're all like charges. They don't repel each other, but they respond to the applied electric field. Okay, so it's a very strange kind of a charge, right? So now, yes. What are the degrees of freedom that I should consider for a Newtonian particle?
So it will be x, y, z, whichever direction it wants to.
That's correct. X, y, z, and what else?
And a particular direction in which it will go if potential is applied.
Particular direction, yes. So that is given fully by the R vector, right? The R vector as a function of time will describe the position of a certain particle and also its direction, correct?
Yes, sir.
Of motion. So the thing is, the direction of motion exactly, how will that get specified? So this is specifying the position of the particle. So as you rightly said, we also need to specify the direction of motion, velocity, right? Or momentum.
Momentum.
Exactly. So the R and P are the variables that need to be considered for the classical particle, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And what are the equations of motion for this classical particle? Can you describe that? So if I write down dr by dt, and I write down dp by dt, then what will come on the right hand side? Let's say non-relativistic, okay? So can you tell me what is the rate of change of the position vector?
V equals to u plus at, so.
V equal to u plus at is valid only for a constant acceleration, right? So if the acceleration were not constant in time, then this is not a valid equation. Okay, so yes. In general, so this is an equation which is true for uniform acceleration, but let's say in general, what is dr by dt given, what is dr by dt equal to? It's velocity, just a velocity, right? Sir. Yeah, and velocity can be described in terms of momentum as p by m. Correct?
Yeah.
So P is mv. And then what is the what is Newton's second law tell us? Dp by dt equal to?
Mass into acceleration. So
correct.
M.
Which is the external force, right? Force. So this external force will be given to us. Let's say there is an electric field or there could be some other kinds of forces, right? So all of that is included in the F external. Okay, thanks. You can mute yourself. So this is what,
thank you.
So these two equations, if we write it for every single particle in the system, F external as applied to the ith particle, right? Then we can describe the dynamics of all of these particles. Okay. So this is the level at, and why are we saying this is classical or Newtonian? Because we have used the Newton's second law, basically, right? dp by dt is equal to f external. So the thing is, now this is a completely classical treatment. Now we want to do, we want to incorporate quantum mechanics into this. Okay. So we want to do a semi-classical treatment, which goes beyond the Newtonian treatment, which means, let's say I now consider these as electrons, which are identical particles, which are quantum particles, but moving about in a periodic potential, right? So if they are moving about in a periodic potential, then we know that the eigenstates of these particles are actually Bloch states. Okay. So the first question then would be, Ritam, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Ritam, when I apply an electric field, then will the Bloch states remain the eigenstates? Is the Bloch's theorem valid? What do you think?
No, sir. Then the potential does not remain the periodic.
Very good. So, as you said, when we apply an electric field, then the potential does not remain periodic. What do you think happens to it?
If we apply electric field in the z direction, then we can think that the potential becomes QEZ if Q is the charge.
So it's you have assumed some sort of a linear potential, right?
Yeah.
But why should it be always linear?
Oh.
Linear is true only in vacuum, isn't it?
Yes.
Suppose I had a metal, right, in which there are free electrons, and then you apply this potential, then you apply this electric field. Do you expect the potential to be linearly varying inside the metal?
No,
it does not actually, right? So you have to solve the full Poisson's equation and then figure out what is the potential according to the boundary conditions. Okay.
Yes.
Right. So what Ritam is saying is that suppose I have a metal and apply an electric field, an external electric field, then the potential could have some non-monotonic form, could have some very strange form, right? And because of this, the periodic potential that I had in the absence of the electric field now gets disturbed because the external field has changed the periodicity, or it has destroyed the periodicity, right? So if the periodicity has been destroyed, then the Bloch's theorem is not really valid. Okay, so the Bloch's theorem is not valid. Now, if Bloch's theorem is not valid, then it means that the K is not a good quantum number. Do you agree, Ritam?
Yes, sir.
So where does this statement come from, that the K is not a good quantum number?
We cannot directly find the momentum states. We need to use the extra term in the potential and write down the Hamiltonian. And
very nice. Yeah. So what Ritam is saying is that if we had a completely periodic potential, then we know that we have proved the Bloch's theorem, and we have shown that K is a good quantum number because all the eigenstates can be indexed with the crystal momentum K. However, when we add this extra potential on top of the periodic potential, and that potential, that extra potential due to the electric field, is not a periodic potential, then we have to again solve the problem, right? And we have to again find out the eigenstates, and those eigenstates may not have a single K. In fact, for those states, we might have to construct linear superpositions of the Bloch states with different K values, and those would give us the eigenstates, right? So as soon as we apply an electric field, what I'm trying to tell you is that the entire formalism that was developed, the band structure, band theory, and so on, is not strictly valid. So what do we do? Any idea? So Ritam, you can mute yourself.
Okay, sir.
Dipanjana?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
I'm not very sure about that.
Okay. Yes, I mean, it's not very easy, right? So the point is, suppose I turn on the electric field, then we know that the K is not a good quantum number. Now, can we do some sort of a, you know, perturbative or a semi-classical kind of a formalism? So let me start from the following. Okay, let's try to apply the same Newton's laws that we had, okay, but for electrons inside a periodic potential. Let's try to do that. Okay, and let me write down the Newton's laws. It was this, and it was dp by dt is f external. So this was pure Newton's laws. Let's try to apply the Newton's laws, but to electrons in a periodic potential, assuming that the block states are still eigenstates, in the sense that applying the electric field, we'll assume that the K is still a good quantum number, but it can change due to the application of an electric field. So the electron can go from one K state to another K state, okay, due to the application of electric field. So in that sense, we are thinking of the electric field as a very small perturbation over the periodic potential. Okay, so let's try to apply this. Dr by dt is this. So if I use dr by dt, the position of an electron, okay, the rate of change of position, what should I write for the momentum p for an electron inside a periodic potential? Can you tell me? What is the momentum of a block state electron? Hello?
H cross K?
H cross K, yeah. So it's H cross K by M, correct? And now the dp by dt that we have, we can write this as d by dt of H cross K, okay, is equal to F external. Now this F external is usually some sort of a Lorentz force, right? So there could be a combination of electric field and magnetic field. So this would be minus E, which is the charge, right? E plus, and E could be spatially dependent and it could also be time dependent, plus V of, let's say the nth band K cross B of R comma T, okay? So if you see these equations, then what we have done is we have still, you know, retained the K index, and the momentum is now described by H cross K. So, and the force is now described by the electric field. But then you see here, there is an input from the band structure, which is Vn of K. Okay. And this Vn of K is what is there here, which is this. So, this H cross K by chem, K by M is actually true only when the momentum. So in general, the Vn of K is not equal to H cross K by M. Okay. So can somebody tell me why is that? What should I write in general for the Vn of K?
The block states are not momentum eigenstates.
Correct. So this is true. So Vn of K is not equal to H cross K by M in general, isn't it?
Yes.
So when is it equal to this?
When the periodic potential term is not present.
Okay. Absolutely. So for free electrons, correct? So yeah. For free electrons, the epsilon K is given by H cross squared K squared by 2M. And there, if I do something, I get this relation. What should I do to this to get this?
Sir, can you please repeat it again?
Yeah, sure. What I'm saying is, how is in general group velocity defined? That is what I wanted to ask. So in general, group velocity is defined not as Vn of K equal to H cross K by M, isn't it?
No. It is defined as d omega by dk.
Or gradient of the ek. With respect to K, right?
Yes.
So it's Vn of K is in general defined as the gradient of K gradient of Ek with respect to K. So this is equal to H cross K by M only for free electrons, for which the dispersion is given by H cross K squared by 2M, right? But in general, this is not equal. Okay, so what we should do is we should replace this by the more general term, right, which is equal to Vn of K, and this Vn of K will be given by the gradient with respect to K of En K. Okay, so that's what we need to do. And this would actually give us the dr by dt. Now there are these factors of H cross and so on. And if you want to be more accurate, then this is what it is. Okay. So the semi-classical equations of motion, which incorporate the block states into the formalism, okay, are these. Semi-classical equations are dr by dt is equal to the Vn of K, which is equal to 1 by H cross gradient of K, Enk. Okay, so this is one equation, and the other equation is dk by dt is given by 1 or minus E by H cross times E of r comma t plus Vn of k cross B of r comma t. Now these form a set of self-consistent equations, and using these we can once we know the band structure of the system, we can then find out what is the effect of the electric field and magnetic field on the position and the momentum or the k state of the electrons. Okay, and using these equations, in fact, you can understand de Haas-Von-Alphen oscillations and many other phenomena. So these equations are the basis for the de Haas-Von-Alphen oscillation formalism, using which one can find the Fermi surface of experimentally of metals and other systems. So it's a very powerful set of equations, and it's very useful also. Okay, but now,
sir, I have a question.
Yes, go on.
Can you please go to the page again?
Can I please go to
this page?
Yeah.
Here I have placed Vn of k in place of P by M. But when I am calculating dp by dt, I have placed ddt of h cross k.
Correct. That's correct. So the H cross K has been said, I mean, what we have used there is the P equal to H cross K exactly. But here for the dr by dt, we have used Vnk. So that is, in fact, seems like an inconsistent thing to do. Very good. Okay. However, if you now put in here the Vnk itself, okay, so dVnk of by dt itself, then you get a higher order equation. Because what you will get is you will get gradient of Vn of k into dk by dt. So what I'm saying is, so here ideally we should have kept here dVnk or m times this equal to the f external. That's what your point is, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And if we do this, then you can see that I should write here m times. Now this I can use the chain rule again. And this becomes now gradient. Let's say I take some particular direction. Okay, so then the gradient this Vn of k times dk by dt. Okay, and this would involve in some sense double derivatives of the Ek. Okay, you agree? This involves double derivatives of Ek because Vn yes. itself is a derivative of Ek, right? So.
Yes.
Now, if you have a double derivative of Ek and I write it in this way, then you can see that this is actually the effective mass. This is M inverse of Ij, the effective mass tensor. Right? If we calculate it close to some k point. Do you see that?
Yes.
Okay. So what one can do is in the semi-classical formalism, one can replace this M by the M effective, the effective band mass, right? which arises because of the band structure, and then this equation is valid. Is that okay now?
Okay.
Yeah. So, see, the thing is, this is anyway not a very rigorous formalism. There are various levels of approximation involved. And you can keep improving the level of approximations. As you said, we need not have taken the effective mass as a constant. We can take the effective mass itself as a function of k, right? And then when we are solving the dk by dt equation, we can include that effective mass as a function of k into the equation. Okay. And indeed, if you want to be more and more accurate, you should start doing that, right? So, but at the first level, one ignores such things and one says that, okay, at the level of, semi-classical dynamics or the first level dynamics, one can ignore such complicated, complications and work with just the bare mass. Then one can start including the effective mass only at the valence band maximum or the conduction band minimum. And if you want to be even more accurate, let's say for metals, not for semiconductors, then you have to include this double derivative exactly at every k point that you're trying to solve for. Okay.
Okay.
But so the question now is, Anustup, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Anustup, now in these equations, can I take into account things like impurities or defects? Can I take into account, say, electron, phonon scattering? And also, can I take into account electron-electron scattering? Which of these can I take into account into this equation?
Sir, I'm not sure. Don't know.
That's okay. You need not be sure. Can you think? So where in these equations can I include impurity effects or scattering of an electron from an impurity?
So in velocity.
In velocity. How do I do that? Why did you say that? You mean in the first equation, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in the first equation, we have 1 by h cross gradient of k, en of k, correct?
Yes, sir.
So do you think the en of k will get modified because of impurities?
Yes, sir. Potential won't be periodic then.
Potential won't be periodic. So will enk remain at all? Will enk be the eigenvalues of the electron in a periodic potential problem?
No,
you're
sir.
Right. When we add impurities, the periodicity of the potential is destroyed, right?
Yes, sir.
And once we destroy that, will the enk remain the eigen energies of the electrons in a periodic potential problem?
No, sir.
No, right? So which means the concept of the en of k itself goes away.
Yes, sir.
So if we want to retain that, right, as and treat the impurities and defects as a perturbation, can we treat such effects in these equations? It doesn't seem like.
No, sir. No, sir.
Right? Because we have retained the k index, and we can't really, modify these equations to include scattering of electrons, because what we are saying is scattering will change the momentum of a certain electron from k to k dash.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And that kind of a scattering, whether it is elastic, whether it is inelastic and so on, that instantaneous change in the momentum cannot be taken into account into these equations.
Yes, sir.
Right. What about electron phonon scattering?
No, sir.
No, right? Yeah. Very nice. So the electron phonon scattering also has exactly the same problem.
Yes,
that
sir.
Is, if I take one electron coming in and it scatters out with a different momentum, there is a phonon somewhere involved, then that phonon also is going to have some energy, right? So this is an inelastic form of scattering, and that also cannot be taken into account. Similarly, if I take electron-electron scattering, And that also has the same problem, that when an electron scatters off another electron, then there could be an exchange of energy involved, and there could also be an exchange of momentum involved, right? So yes, those kind of things cannot be taken into account in these semi-classical level of equations. Okay, yeah, you can mute yourselves.
Sir, can we have coherent scattering?
Not in this. So again, for coherent scattering also, these equations will not, actually these equations are not possible to use in case of any scattering. Okay, they involve a smooth transition of the position and of the k. Right, so as soon as you involve a smooth transition, you cannot include scattering effects, because scattering effects are in some sense instantaneous changes, or changes in a very, very short while of the momentum. So even if it is coherent, okay? So coherent backscattering effects like Anderson localization and so on also cannot be taken into account in these formalisms. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah, so basically the argument is that if I evolve these equations in time and I take the electric fields and magnetic fields to be smoothly varying, then these equations will give me perfectly smooth trajectories of the momentum k. Okay, so in that sense, I will not be able to describe any sudden transitions in k which happen because of any kind of scattering. That's the idea. Okay, so because of that, I cannot describe any scattering within these equations, and for that we have to include, we have to go to the Boltzmann transport formalism. Okay, and the Boltzmann transport formalism goes beyond the single electron formalism and can include scattering effects as well. Okay, so now before I go to the Boltzmann transport formalism, let me ask Gautam, are you online?
So
yeah, so Gautam, let me consider a system in equilibrium. Okay, electrons in a periodic potential and they are in equilibrium, which means that there is some sort of a canonical ensemble, there is a reservoir, and the system of electrons is at a constant temperature. There is no electric field, so there is no current in the system, and there is a certain distribution function for the electrons. So what is that distribution function?
Fermi-Dirac distribution function.
Okay, Fermi-Dirac distribution function. Okay, so let me write that. Okay, so FFD of ENK is given by 1 over e to the power ENK minus mu by KBT plus 1. Correct?
Yes, sir.
This is the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Where this ENK is the band energy of a certain block state, which is the nth band, and the crystal momentum K. Mu is the chemical potential and T is the temperature.
Yes, sir.
Good. So what does this distribution function tell us? What information does this have?
The distribution of energy of different electrons.
Distribution of energies of different electrons? Is it the distribution of energy? So the distribution of energy is already given to you by En of k. Okay?
Yes, sir.
I want to know whether a particular state is occupied or not. Isn't it?
The probability, yes, sir.
So this gives me the occupation probability, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So this gives me the occupation probability of a certain state ENK. See, remember ENK corresponds to a certain state. It's the eigen energy of the block state in the nth band and crystal momentum K. You agree?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this gives me the occupation probability. Now the question is, if I go to non-equilibrium, out of equilibrium situation, and how do I do that?
Okay.
To go to an out of equilibrium situation, I apply an electric field. Okay, this is an electric field. I apply an electric field. First of all, does applying an electric field take the system out of equilibrium?
I think so.
So let me ask you this question. Let's say I have a metal, okay? And I take this metal and keep it between the plates of a parallel capacitor. And this parallel capacitor, let's say, is highly charged. So there is a plus Q and a minus Q, and there's no contact between these two. Okay, so this is the metal. So with this electric field, right, the there will be a certain charge redistribution inside the metal.
Yes, sir.
Agree? Now,
yes, sir.
Once a charge redistribution happens, right, and you wait for a long enough time, then is the system going to be in equilibrium or is it going to be out of equilibrium?
No, it will be in equilibrium because the electric field is constant.
Exactly.
Yes, it will be in equilibrium.
Right? So there will be some redistribution of the charges, but yes. Is there any current flowing?
No, sir.
No, right? Because we have created an open circuit condition.
Yes.
Isn't it? So since we have created an open circuit condition, there's going to be no current flowing in this system. Hence, the system will be in equilibrium.
Yes, sir.
Okay. But if we take the same metal and we put this in some circuit,
yes,
right, then even though there is an electric field, there is actually a current that is flowing.
Yes.
Right. And when the current is flowing, then the system is out of equilibrium.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now, if it is out of equilibrium, yeah, thanks, Gautam, you can mute yourself. So if it is out of equilibrium, there are two things that we need to consider. One is when the system is in a transient stage, and the other is in the steady state. So a transient state is when the current could be, for example, a function of space and time. Okay, so it's changing. If you stay at a certain point in space, then the current is changing with time, or as you move along, the current is changing with space and time, right? But in the steady state, things are not time dependent. So if you stand at any point in space, you will find that the current is exactly the same, right? The current could be different at a different point in space, but not as a function of time. So the system has gone into a steady state after a very long time, right? So this steady state, in the steady state, you, or even in the transient, you can describe a different distribution function. So the Fermi Dirac distribution function is not going to be the distribution function out of equilibrium, and we have to define a new distribution function. Okay, and that new distribution function could be, for example, written something like this. Okay, so this is a distribution function out of equilibrium. Okay. And this, for example, now describes the number of electrons in a certain volume d cube r. Okay. And the states in which have a momentum close to h cross k, and in a certain volume in k space, which is d cube k, and at a certain time t. Okay. So I can write this as, if I take f of r, p and t, okay, and then multiply it by d cube r, d cube k, let me write this as k, and then 2 pi q. Then this describes the number of electrons in, and this also has an index n here, in band n, okay, with positions within d cube r of r, and wave vectors within d cube k of k at time t. Okay. So Krishna Kanhaiya Tiwari is Krishna is are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so does this does the definition of this function is it consistent with quantum mechanics?
So we are specifying both the position, not position, but we are specifying the volume. We are specifying a range of wave vectors about k.
Yes. So is it consistent with quantum mechanics or inconsistent?
Since there are inaccuracy of dqr and dqk,
yes,
it should be consistent.
Well, doesn't it depend on how you define dq bar and dq k?
Yeah, it depends.
It depends, isn't it? So how should I define it? Yeah. Tell me. So what is it that is being implicitly assumed here? So what you are saying is that since the position and momentum both are being both are simultaneous degrees of freedom here, we must choose the volume element in real space and the volume element in k space in such a way that the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle is not violated, correct?
Yeah.
Right? So if we had violated that by taking d cube r going to 0 and d cube k going to 0, we would only be able to do classical mechanics.
Yeah.
But by choosing the volume element in K space and the volume element in real space in such a way that they don't violate the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, then we it should be then this is quantum mechanically consistent. Okay.
Yeah.
Right. So to do that, yeah. Thanks, Krishna. You can mute yourself. So to do that, what we can do is we can assume that this volume element in real space is large enough compared to, for example, the atoms, the interatomic spacing. Okay, it's much larger, right? And in other words, what we are saying is that the atomic details are not going to be very important when we look at the variations in the perturbations. When we look at the variations in the externally applied electric field or magnetic field and so on, they should not be varying on the atomic scale. Or for example, let's say we are shining some electromagnetic wave on the system. Then this electromagnetic wave intensity should be roughly, you know, very smoothly varying over the entire sample. It should not be rapidly varying, okay? So spatially. So if things are spatially smooth in terms of, you know, they are varying only over thousands of lattice parameters, then in that sense, we can still define a distribution function, which is a function of the spatial coordinate as well as the momentum coordinate. Okay, so this is a this is the level at which we are going to look at the transport phenomena. That is by defining a new distribution function, which is not only a function of the k as an equilibrium, but also a function of real space. Okay, and through this we are now going to, and by finding this distribution function, we can then try to understand what is the current in the system due to, let's say, thermal gradient or a potential gradient and all kinds of other phenomena. Okay, so it's a semi-classical formalism still, because we have both position and momentum coordinates simultaneously, right? But and we are keeping track of those, right? We are looking at the changes in both of those. But the quantum mechanical thing comes in because we are saying that this f is a deviation from the Fermi Dirac distribution function. Also, quantum mechanics comes into picture by saying that we are still retaining the crystal momentum coordinates. And the third thing is that we are still saying that the r, the real space d cube r, has to be large enough such that the Heisenberg's principle is not violated. Okay, so with all these three caveats, we can use this formalism and write down an equation of motion for this Boltzmann distribution function. So this is not the Maxwell Boltzmann distribution function. Okay, this is a new kind of distribution function, and the equation of motion that we will be writing for this will be called the Boltzmann transport equation. Okay, so that is what we are going to do now. Yes.
Sir, can you just repeat the incorporating of quantum mechanics, because d cube k, k has a minimum value of 2 pi by L if we consider one dimensional. So that sir, dk cannot be zero. So
no, it cannot be zero. The thing is, see, it can be so small, and you can take the d cube r to be so small that you can violate the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle.
Yes.
Okay. So mathematically, if you define the distribution function, and you have perturbations in your system which are very rapidly varying on the scale of the lattice parameters, okay, then you have to consider here f of r being varying on the atomic scale.
Yeah.
Understand, right?
Yes.
So in that sense, you could actually violate the uncertainty principle, in which case you can't use quantum mechanics. Okay, you have to restrict yourself to classical formalism. Yeah.
That means the spatial distance should be large enough so that we can incorporate quantum mechanics.
What I'm saying is, see, when we are looking at the number of electrons in band N with positions within d cube r of r, we will then consider a sufficiently large enough space, okay, which is small compared to the system size, but large compared to the lattice parameter.
Yes, okay. Sir.
So for example, if you had a 1 millimeter sample, I could consider, let's say, a 1 micron.
1 micrometer.
Exactly. Yeah. So 1 micron. So that would be
but
large.
But not in angstrom.
Exactly. Okay. Yes, so sir. That should still be fine. So on that scale, you can still see, if you take a 1 micron sample, you can still define a crystal momentum for that. Okay. So that is still bulk as far as the atomic positions are concerned, and you will still have a band structure and so on. But that band structure will now change once you go to a, let's say I take a full sample and I divide this sample in terms of microns. So let's say each step is 1 micron, and I discretize the electric field or the potential in such a way that the potential is constant here, like this, right? A stepwise potential. Okay. So in that sense, in this region, I can solve the problem with this potential. In this region, I can solve the problem with this potential, and so on. And the potential is constant over that region. Okay. So then what is happening is the periodic potential gets a constant shift. Okay. So that is the underlying microscopic thing that we are doing here, in the sense that we are discretizing the electric field in such a way that it is piecewise constant over, you know, large enough scales where we can still use the Bloch's theorem. Okay. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Sir, I have another question. It is also for a transient case, it is explicitly time dependent. So when it is time dependent, though there is no energy term associated with it, still when we apply any external field to the system, energy will be automatically associated with it. And I want to know whether this there is any restriction to the time for that energy, because energy and time is also internally connected.
So you can't instantaneously change the energy of the system, that is for sure. So you will be transferring a certain amount of energy to the system. And remember, when you, let's say, turn on an electric field, then the electrons are going to accelerate. And if they accelerate, it means that they're going to gain energy. Okay. And if they just go on gaining energy, the system will run off to infinite temperature. You understand? See, if you just go on supplying energy to a system, the system will run off to an infinite temperature system, because the energy will become infinite. Okay.
Yes, sir.
But that doesn't happen in the real system. In a real system, there is always, if there is a source, there is also a sink.
Yes.
Okay. So there has to be some dissipative mechanism by which the energy that you are putting in will be dissipated out. And if the dissipation mechanism, and when the dissipation mechanism and the input mechanism, when they will balance out, that is when you will get the steady state.
Steady state, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So, while this steady state is being established, that is when you get the transient. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. All right. So, this is where the Boltzmann transport formalism starts. That is, by definition of this new distribution function, fn. It could be spin dependent also, but let me just ignore the spin for the moment. So this is a new distribution function. Okay, new distribution function out of equilibrium. So this is the philosophy of this whole thing. That is, the Fermi Dirac distribution function was the distribution function in equilibrium. And when you go out of equilibrium, you have to find the new distribution function. You don't know, right? So similarly for phonons also, if you disturb the phonons, okay, by putting a thermal gradient, for example, then you have to find a new distribution function. The Bose-Einstein distribution function does not remain the distribution function, okay? So what we have to do is we have to look at the total derivative of this distribution function. And we have to also incorporate collisions which can change the distribution function. Okay, so the main idea is that if I have the change in the distribution function, right, and this is usually written as a total derivative of f. Okay, so by the way, the Boltzmann transport formalism can be considered from many, many different points of view. And there is one point of view which is which comes from the point of view of continuity equation, Liouville equation, and so on. And there you have to look at fluid dynamics concepts. Okay, what I'm trying to say is that there is a hydrodynamic point of view. Let me explain what I mean. Hydrodynamic point of view, where you think of the electrons as a fluid. Okay. And then you write down a certain equation for that fluid, which is basically the continuity equation, right? And that continuity equation, however, ignores all microscopic phenomena. So what you do is you incorporate hydrodynamics, but you also incorporate the microscopic phenomena through something called a collision integral. Okay, so there are many different formalisms that you will find in the literature for deriving the Boltzmann transport equation. In this course, I'm going to give you one of the simplest possible formalisms, okay, without going into the full, Hamilton-Jacobi formalism or the, you know, much more rigorous formalisms are there. I'm not going to go into that. And I'm going to give you a much more simpler point of view. And that formalism goes as this, that derivation goes like this. If I want to find the change in the distribution function, I have to look at the total derivative of the distribution function, and the total derivative is basically given by del d by d. Yeah.
Why are we not considering temperature also as a parameter for this distribution function?
So the temperature is an implicit parameter. So right now what I have done is, so you're absolutely right. There could be a thermal gradient also. Okay. And the thermal gradient is in fact embedded in the T of R. So if there is a thermal gradient, then the temperature will be a function of R, right?
Yes, sir.
You agree? So if the temperature is a function of R, then if I have a sample here, then I could have a temperature T1 here, T2 here, T3 here, and Tn here. Okay. Then yes, what I'm saying is that the distribution function here and the distribution function here need not be the same. Okay, see, where is the electric field in this? You can ask the same question here for the electric field also, isn't it? Where is the potential here?
Okay.
Right? So the potential is also a function of R, isn't it?
Yes, I get this.
So all of those are implicitly present in the distribution function. In fact, the question that you asked is very interesting because although potential can be described as a smooth function of R, can you ever describe temperature as a smooth function of R? So was this, who asked this question? Sorry, I didn't see.
Purnendu.
Purnendu. So good that you asked this. So can you go ahead and argue that the temperature cannot be a smooth function of R? See, the potential can be derived, written down as through these electromagnetic equations or the Maxwell's equations, and then you can find the solutions through whatever equation you have, like Poisson's equation and other kinds of equations. Okay, but the temperature is actually a thermodynamic quantity.
Yes, sir.
Do you agree? Right. So if it's a thermodynamic quantity, can it actually be defined as a smooth function of position? Yes or no? No, that's correct.
No, no, sir.
Be. Yes, it cannot be. But why?
Yes.
Why can we not describe the temperature as a smooth function of position? So the reason
these are state variables.
It's a state, right? So it's a macroscopic variable, and we define temperature only for a macroscopic number of particles, right? Yes, so if you define at a given position, obviously there can't be a macroscopic number of particles, right?
Yes.
So you have to consider in some sense a system, and then you have to do a coarse graining of that system, like I was describing in the previous slide, right? So that coarse graining should be such that this coarse grained system is much bigger than the atomic scale, but much smaller than the system size. Okay.
Yes.
So in which case you can still define temperature in each part of this discretization, in each part of this coarse grained level system. Okay. So the temperature will not become a smooth function of the position, but you can divide the system into certain parts, and then you can say, okay, in this part it is T1, T2, T3, and so on. And when you plot T1, T2, T3, then you have some sort of a curve like this. And then you can join and say, okay, this looks like a smooth curve. Okay. But in fact, it can never be smooth, right? Because the temperature itself cannot be defined locally. Okay.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Good. So the total derivative of this distribution function is d by dt of this f. And what we say, the Boltzmann transport equation, the essence of Boltzmann transport equation is that the total derivative of this distribution function is something called a collision integral. Or all the microscopic phenomena that can change the distribution function are written down here. Microscopic phenomena, okay, are given here, and this total derivative involves the drift and diffusion. Let me explain. Okay, so the left hand side basically is describing drift and diffusion, and the right hand side describes all the microscopic phenomena like scattering processes, for example, okay, which can change the distribution function. And we'll go over each of these, okay, because each understanding this this particular concept that the left hand side involves drift and diffusion and the right hand side involves scattering is very important. So let me go over the left hand side first. This is the total derivative of f, and because there are three variables here, I should write first of all explicitly whatever the derivative of f is with respect to time. So it's a partial derivative. The second thing is I should take the derivative of this r here with respect to of the f with respect to r, and then take the derivative of r with respect to time. Okay, so it's a chain rule that I'm trying to apply. So what I will do is I'll take a spatial gradient of the derivative, and this spatial gradient I have to then take dr by dt. Okay, and the third thing is I have to take the k gradient, the momentum space gradient of f, and then dot this with dk by dt. Okay. So now you can see the different terms here. Okay. So remember, the dk by dt in the semi-classical level was basically coming from the external force, right? So this is called the drift term. Okay. And this here is called the diffusion term. So the dr by dt is basically how this particle is diffusing. And even in the absence of any electric field, this term will be present, right? So this is called the diffusion term. And this is any explicit dependence on time. So this is the transient term. So in the steady state, for example, this term would be absent. Because in the steady state, the distribution function will not be a function of time explicitly, right? There will be implicitly a function of time in this way. There will be dr by dt, there will be dk by dt. But explicitly, the distribution function will not depend on time, right? So these are the three different terms. And now we can simplify each of these terms in the following way, okay? So this dr by dt, let me just give me one moment. Okay, so the dr by dt is what we had written at the semi-classical level as vn of k, and the dk by dt we had written it as f external. Okay, so well, there was h cross also, so let's add here 1 by h cross. Okay. So that we can now replace here. So this becomes del f by del t plus this gradient with respect to the spatial coordinate of f dot v. So this is a vector vn of k. Okay. And then we have gradient with respect to k of f, and this we'll write it as it is. And then dk by dt is f external by h cross. Okay. So what one can see from here is that the left hand side is a linear is linear in the f. Okay. So this distribution function appears only linearly, right? But what we will see now is that on the right hand side, when we include the scattering processes, that is where the non-linearity comes in. Okay, and the non-linearity will come in a very simple way. You can actually intuitively understand this, because suppose I want to consider an electron phonon scattering. Okay, and in an electron phonon scattering, for example, I want to know, or I am looking at a process which looks like this. Let's say k plus q, where this is the phonon. Okay, and the phonon has a momentum q. So what I'm trying to figure out is the transition probability for an electron to go from a state k to state k plus q, and a phonon of momentum q is being absorbed in this process, right? So if this process has to have a finite probability, then the state k has to be occupied, and the state k plus q has to be unoccupied. Okay, so which means that the occupation probability of the state k has to be accounted for, and that occupation probability is given by fk. But this fk plus q has to be unoccupied, which means it has to be 1 minus fk plus q. Okay, and these two have to be multiplied. But not only that, I am also saying that a phonon of momentum q has to be absorbed in this process, right? Which means that the probability of the phonon state with momentum vector q has to be also taken into account, and that is the Bose-Einstein distribution function. Okay, so now you can see that on the right hand side you are going to get terms which are like f squared, okay, or fk into fk plus q, and this makes this whole equation terribly complicated. And in fact, it makes it a integral differential equation. You will see that. Okay. And not only that, it's also going to be nonlinear in F. Okay. So the actual Boltzmann transport equation, if you want to take into account terms like defect scattering or terms like electron phonon, electron-electron scattering, then it's a horribly complicated equation. However, the state of the art is such that people are actually solving the equations with all the complications included. Okay, and I had mentioned this in the earlier class also, that solving these equations is actually $100 to $1,000 billion business. Okay, because if you want to simulate transport in let's say chips, okay, this microprocessor chips, then you have to incorporate the Boltzmann transport formalism until very recently. Okay, so it turned out that full quantum effects were not really important. And I don't know how many of you know this, but many of us are actually using chips which have a channel width of around 14 nanometer. Okay, and earlier was 22 nanometer. But now the most recent chips which are coming in have a channel width, the transistors have a channel width of let's say less than 10 nanometer. Okay, I think 7 nanometer or so. And that's where real quantum effects like tunneling and other kinds of effects, they actually come into play. And there, the Boltzmann transport formalism actually breaks down. Okay, so people are trying to now modify and then go over to something called the quantum master equation and also incorporate effects which go beyond this semi-classical formalism. Okay, but until recently and even now, you know, most of the chips that we use are actually based on modeling through the Boltzmann transport formalism. Okay, so so the left hand side part I hope is clear. Now I'm going to go over the right hand side part. So are there any doubts in the left hand side part? Is it clear? There is a transient term, there is a diffusion term, and there is a drift term. And the left-hand side term, left-hand side equation is linear in F. Okay, it's not non-linear. Okay, so given this, let's go over to the right-hand side part, which is the collisions. So what we are saying is that the total derivative of this distribution function is determined by all the scattering processes in the system, which can change the F. Okay, the F at a certain position R, or the number of electrons which are in a certain volume around the position R, in a certain volume in K space around the momentum K and at time T. Okay, so what is this collision integral, this IK of F, which is called the collision integral. So this collision integral is in general a contribution from all the different scattering processes. Okay, so let's start listing them. Disha, are you online?
Okay.
Yeah. So Disha, can we list out all the different scattering processes that could happen in this system of electrons moving in a periodic potential?
Electron-electron scattering.
Electron-electron scattering, okay. Then?
Electron-phonon.
Okay. Then?
Phonon
scattering could happen. The thing is, see, we are looking at the total derivative of the electronic distribution function, right? So in some sense I should have written here F electron. Okay, so what we are looking at now is only the changes in the electronic distribution function. So the phonon-phonon scattering is indeed an actual scattering process in the system. Okay, but is it going to directly affect the electronic distribution function?
No,
it's not going to directly influence, right? It will actually influence the distribution function of phonons, which in turn can influence the electronic distribution function. Okay, through electron-phonon scattering. So what I'm saying is, imagine that in a particular system, the electronic part and the phonon part are completely independent of each other. Okay, there is absolutely no electron-phonon coupling in the system. If that was the case, then would you consider phonon-phonon scattering in the in this equation?
No,
right? So it is appearing only through electron phonon scattering. Okay, so electron phonon scattering actually subsumes in some way phonon phonon scattering also. Okay, what else could happen?
If the defect present.
Yes, so electron impurity scattering. Correct?
Yes.
Okay, anything else can you envisage?
Not that I can think about.
Sorry?
I can't think about anything else.
I'll give you a hint. You said here photons, right? Phonons, sorry.
Yeah.
You could have other scatterings also, right?
Is there external stimuli? Is there
Can you speak a little bit louder? I can't hear you.
Like if you are giving external stimuli, then you can have electron photon as well.
Yes, electron photon. What else? What are the other ons that you know? So what are spin waves called? Magnons.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you can have an electron magnon scattering. Okay? You could have, for example, electron plasmon scattering. See, plasmons are themselves density waves of electrons. Okay? But they could also scatter individual electrons. Then magnons are spin waves, and they could also scatter individual electrons, right? So there are all these different and even more kinds of scattering processes which are possible. Okay, and in each of these you have to consider whether the spin is getting flipped, whether it's a spin independent process, whether it's a spin dependent process, and whether it is elastic, whether it is inelastic, and there are, you know, all kinds of considerations which are specific to each of these different kinds of scatterings. Okay, so yeah, you can mute yourself. So each of these, yeah.
Sir, two phonon absorption process can be happen here.
Yes, two phonon absorption is a phonon phonon scattering.
No, electron phonon and electron. Yeah, sorry, electron phonon and phonon. That means electron scatters with a phonon and
no, that cannot
go to the another state.
It cannot happen. See, what you are saying is this. Let's say an electron comes in, okay, and you are saying something like this. Okay, Q1, Q2. So let's say a phonon comes in, it gets absorbed, and a new phonon is created with momentum Q2, which is basically equal to K plus Q1, correct? This kind of a process violates charge and mass conservation. Okay? Because the electron is being absorbed, no? So in a non-relativistic system, this is not possible.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is that each of these different scattering phenomena is actually a story in itself. Okay, one has to write down models for electron-electron scattering, then think of whether if the spin is involved, then what happens. What is you have to look at, for example, whether it is mediated through phonons or not, or whether it is direct Coulomb repulsion. Right? So there are all kinds of considerations involved in each of these different scattering phenomena. Okay? So what we say is these are the different models of scattering. So that is the usual jargon in the literature, that each of these has a certain model. Okay? And what we will do in this course is that we will write down a few very special models. Okay, so one of the simplest models of this collision integral is called the relaxation time approximation. Okay, so a very simple model of the collision integral is the relaxation time approximation. I'm sorry, relaxation time. And what this says is that the IK of F is given by minus of F of R K T minus F zero of R and K divided by some tau of E of K. Okay, so let me explain. So if you remember, on the left hand side, we had a DTF. Okay, and on the right hand side, if you see in the literature, sometimes they write del F by del T collision. Okay, so this is basically the IK of F. And what one is doing is the simplest model for this collision integral is this relaxation time approximation, where instead of saying that there is a continuous derivative in time on the right hand side, you say that there is a particular relaxation time. Okay. And this has been discretized as delta F by delta T, where the delta F is the change from the equilibrium. Okay, it's basically F minus F zero. and the denominator is just a tau, which is the relaxation time due to whatever microscopic scattering process is present in the system. Okay, so this relaxation time is specific to a certain band and a certain momentum k, but it does not tell you what is the kind of scattering that you have considered. And there also, so there are sub models of this also which are very important. For example, you can consider the scattering due to electron phonons, and that will give you a different dependence of tau on the En of k. And if you consider electron-electron scattering, then the tau dependence or the En dependence of the tau will be different. Okay, the momentum dependence of the relaxation time depends on what kind of scattering you are considering, right? So there are sub-models to this model as well, right? But the simplification for with this model is that the entire Boltzmann transport equation remains linear in F. Okay, it doesn't become non-linear, right? So it is it becomes a solvable equation, and by solving this, you can then incorporate, you know, more and more sophisticated models for the relaxation time. Okay, so the only simplification that this gives you is that the equation becomes exactly solvable. Okay, so this is called the relaxation time approximation, and we will actually go ahead and solve this for a finite electric field, and we will see, we will derive the expression for conductivity, okay, conductivity tensor, but that is later. Okay, so this is one of the simplest models, and here the tau could be, for example, from electron phonon or electron phonon. All of that is actually buried in this. Okay, it's not being made explicit. I don't know where that tau is coming from. You just give me the tau, I will solve the equation and give you the final solution for the non-equilibrium distribution function. Okay, that's the idea in this simple model, right? Any doubts? So it's a very generic model, right? Which is not specific to a particular scattering process. Okay.
Okay. Sir, is that minus the IK expression is minus FRKT minus F naught?
It's minus F. For the relaxation time approximation, it is minus F. Yeah.
There are two minus.
This minus is actually outside. Sorry. Okay. It's this. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Sir, if we have more than one scattering process in a system, yeah, in that case, how will the equation look like?
Sure. So there also, one applies something called a Nordheim rule. You might be familiar with this. What you do is you say 1 by tau is 1 by tau 1 plus 1 by tau 2 and so on. Okay. So let's say you have a certain model for the relaxation time dependence on K through electron phonon. Or you could have a certain different model for the electron-electron scattering. Okay, then you find out all those relaxation times individually, and then you use this Nordheim's rule for calculating the total relaxation time, and then use that in the Boltzmann transport equation. Okay, this is what happens at this level, right? But now we are going to another model which treats different scattering processes differently. Okay, but you will see that that is what introduces non-linearity into the equation. Okay, so let's see. The first equation will be for elastic scattering from an impurity. Okay, and an impurity is being considered as a static potential. Static potential which is local. Okay. So the idea is that this static potential is denoted as U of R, and this IK of F is written, let me just write the expression first and then I'll explain. It's written as 2 pi by h cross v integral d cube k dash by 2 pi whole cube mod of Yeah, so let me write the whole thing first. K dash U K dash K whole squared F K dash minus F K delta of E K minus E K dash. Okay, so what are we saying here? So if you look at this expression, then first of all, let's just look at this. There is a delta function here. Okay, So what we are saying is that this is an elastic process in which there is a transfer of momentum of the electron from the state k to the state k dash. Okay, so each of these is actually a block state. So one is considering this matrix element k dash uk here, and this fk dash minus fk is basically the change in the distribution function, right? And there is a delta function which ensures that this is an elastic collision. Okay, but what are we saying here? That we are summing over all the different possible k dash, right? So all we are saying is that there is a electron k, okay, electron in a state k, and that gets scattered from this u of r, right, and goes into k dash. But into what k dash will it go? All possible k dashes are possible. Okay, so we have to consider all the different k dash, which means we have to take an integral over the entire Brillouin zone and consider the matrix element of the k dash uk, right? And then we have to say that there is a f of k dash minus f of k. Okay, so this is basically the Fermi's golden rule. So what we are applying here is basically the Fermi's golden rule. Okay, so this is a model which is specifically for a for an impurity scattering. Okay, so this is what has been considered here. Yeah.
Sir, here if we consider the scattering term, it is something p k k prime d 3 k prime. Sir, the transition from k to k prime and k prime to k is same. So if they are same, when we apply some voltage, the transition probability from is same from 1 to 2 to 2 1, then how we will have effective scattering in this process?
Yeah. So it's true that the k dash uk and the k uk, the matrix element squared, will give you the same contribution. Okay, but if you look at the left hand side, what I have said is that there is a free index k. Okay, so this left hand side basically means that we are keeping k constant but varying the k dash. So the outgoing momentum is k dash in this process, the incoming momentum is k, and that is constant. In other words, what I'm looking at is the change in the distribution function f of r k t. Okay, and what is coming out is f of r k dash comma t. Do you see that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So in that sense, this is not it's not going to be the same for both k and k dash, right? Because this entire equation, the k is actually a fixed number. So for each k, you have to solve this. You see?
Yes, sir. Sir, I just want to say that if we calculate I k prime f and reverse the k and k prime, we will
Wait. So when you say I k dash, right? You can't say I k dash because k dash is actually an integration variable. It's not a fixed number. So this k is actually connecting to all the different k in the Brillouin zone. That is what we are calling k dash. It's not a fixed number. You see, I can write a k double dash. Okay, but for that k double dash, I can again call k dash as the integration variable, and this k will become k double dash. So in some sense, what we are saying here is that an incoming momentum k can scatter into all the different momenta of the Brillouin zone. And for scattering into any different momenta, right, there is a certain matrix element that is involved, which you have to calculate. Okay, that gives you the transition probability from k to k dash. But that k dash is not fixed. It's an integration over the full Brillouin zone. Do you see that?
Yes, sir, I see.
Yeah. So you can't write I k dash where k dash is an integration variable. You understand?
Sir, I understood, but
okay,
actually I was asking.
Let's do one thing. Okay.
I was saying it.
No, wait. So it's just 4 minutes to 3:30. Let me just finish the next one also.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes,
and
sir.
Then we can discuss this.
Yes, sir.
So let me now introduce the electron phonon scattering, and you will see the the one more thing is already you can see that this equation, the Boltzmann transport equation, has become an integral differential equation. Let me just tell you why. Okay, and I think we won't have time for doing the electron phonon scattering, but let me write the full Boltzmann transport equation, del f by del t, and then r dot gradient with respect to r of f, and this is all for a single k, plus k dot gradient with respect to k of f is I k of f, and that is given by 2 pi by h cross sum over k dash belonging to the full Brillouin zone, k dash u k whole squared, f of k dash minus f of k, into delta of e k dash minus e k. Okay, now and this is what we converted to an integral. So here on the left hand side you can see that there are partial derivatives involved. Okay, there are partial derivatives, and on the right hand side you can see there is an integral over f, right? So what this is telling you is that this is become now an integral differential equation, okay, but linear in f. This is still linear, okay, but it has become very complicated. So it's an integral differential equation. You can take second derivatives and eliminate the integral, right? But it will still remain, it will become more complicated. It will become like a second order differential equation, but it will still be linear in f. Okay, there is no non-linear term like f squared and so on. Okay, but it's not easy to solve at all, right? First of all, you will have to solve for the matrix elements. You'll have to find out what is the form of the u k k dash, and then you have to incorporate this and then do an integral of that. But when doing an integral, you don't know what is the f here, right? So you have to assume some sort of a deviation of f from f0, solve this part, then substitute that. So one has to do this iteratively, okay? One has to do it self-consistently. That is one way to do it. Or you discretize the entire equation and then represent it as a matrix in R, K and time, and then solve that big matrix. You have to invert that huge matrix, okay? So there are many different ways of solving these integral differential equations. I'm not going into those, but it's a whole industry in itself, okay? So this is the simplest level scattering, when the electron is scattering against a static impurity, okay? And it's also elastic scattering because we have included a delta function for energy. The energy of the electron is not changing. But you could have, for example, inelastic scattering as in electron phonon or electron electron, and that is what we will consider tomorrow. And tomorrow I'll also hope to derive the conductivity expression in the relaxation time approximation. Okay, so the class is over now. If those of you want to log out can log out. So Shovik, you can ask me the question and we can discuss now.
Okay, sir. Sir, in the last term IKF, representing the transition probability from all the k prime from k.
Not all the k prime. So it represents the transition probability of a single k to all possible k dash.
Yeah, and integration over k dash.
Correct.
That means any k value except the k value in the site.
No, it could be the same k also, but you can see that the f k dash minus f k will become zero. So you know there is don't have to consider that zero as a change. Yeah, that is not really a scattering process.
Yes, sir. So the transition probability is k to any k, other k prime value.
Yeah,
and here, sir, here we can see that the transition probability from k to k prime is also same as k prime to k. If the transition probability from k to k prime and k prime to k are same, I think it is my problem to understand that if the transition probability are same, then there will be no conductivity. And if the transition probability are different, then we can have the conductivity, or the electron can move to another k state and conduct. Correct my concept in this regard.
Okay. So the thing is this, if all the states K had exactly the same probability, then what you're saying is correct. Okay. But each state K has a different probability, which means it has a different value of the probability distribution function. Okay. So what we're considering here mostly would be a partially filled band. And for a partially filled band, going from an occupied to unoccupied, and going from so at any finite temperature, of course, there is a partial probability of occupation. So going from almost occupied to an almost unoccupied state, and going from an almost unoccupied state to an occupied state is not going to be the same. And that you can see from here that there is an fk dash minus fk, which means suppose I was going from fk, which was occupied, to an unoccupied state, and the fk dash is unoccupied. Okay. And if I reverse that, it's not going to be the same. That's why it is, that's why this this collision integral being linear in F is so important. If it was quadratic, then what you are saying is absolutely right.
Yes, okay. Sir. Yeah. Yes, sir, but I understood. That linear, the term fk prime minus fk is doing the doing for whatever required for conductivity. If it is exactly. F square k prime minus f square k or f k prime minus f k whole square, then it will be zero.
Correct. And yes, if you now consider a fully occupied band in which all the f's are exactly one, right, then again you will not have any conductivity. Correct?
Yes, sir. I understood.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Sure. Any other question?
Sir, I have a question here.
Yeah.
If we